Morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the 9th meeting of the Public Audit Committee, and this, the 6th session of the Parliament. Before we begin, can I remind members, witnesses and members of staff that the Parliament's social distancing rules are in force, and also if you are moving around the room or leaving the room or entering the room, if you can wear a face covering. The first item of business that we've got to consider is to agree to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. The principal item we've got on our agenda this morning is to look at community empowerment during COVID-19. There was a report produced by Audit Scotland and the Accounts Commission back in 2019, which was Principles for Community Empowerment, which provides a kind of foundation stone for our discussion this morning. But a briefing was prepared and published late October by, again, Audit Scotland and the Accounts Commission jointly, I think, which looked at how community empowerment had been affected or changed by COVID-19. And so this morning, I'm delighted that we've got a round table discussion of participants with knowledge and experience of how community empowerment has looked over the course of the last 18 months, 2 years. And could I say to those witnesses who join us online, thank you very much for taking the time to give us your insights this morning. There will be, as you would expect, some questions from members of the committee, but it's also quite a discursive session where you can, if you like, ask questions of each other, and it will be a bit more conversational and hopefully not at all like an interrogation. So I'm keen to encourage a kind of free flow of discussion. And by that token, if there are questions that are asked or parts of the discussion that you don't really have any strong views on, or there's nothing that you particularly wish to put on the record, then don't feel obliged to answer every question or take part in every area of the discussion. If you are joining us virtually, the best way to attract our attention that you want to come in and take part is by putting an R in the chat box. The microphones, your microphone will be activated for you, so you don't need to press unmute on your screens. What I'd like to do is, again, welcome you all here. Welcome Stephen Boyle, the Auditor General, who joins us in person in the committee. And what I would like to do, because this is a round table, I'd like us to go around and introduce ourselves, and perhaps you can say a little bit about the organisation that you are here representing this morning. But I want to begin by inviting members of the committee here to just introduce themselves before I go on to ask the witnesses. Sharon.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Sharon Dowie. I'm the MSP for South of Scotland.
Colin Beattie. I'm the MSP for Midlothian, North and Musselburgh.
Craig Hoy, one of the MSPs for the South of Scotland. And just for the record, if I could also just draw attention to my register of interests, because I'll refer to it later, that I'm an East Lothian councillor.
Willie.
Or Kilmarnock, Carnarvon Valley.
Thank you. And can I ask perhaps Stephen Boyle, if you just want to introduce yourself.
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, everybody. My name's Stephen Boyle. I'm the Auditor General for Scotland. And as the Convener says, together with the Accounts Commission, we've produced this update briefing for discussion this morning. And along with the Accounts Commission, we audit around 200 plus public bodies across the public sector in Scotland.
Thank you. David Allen, do you want to introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about the organisation you represent?
Yes, thanks. Good morning, everybody, and thanks for inviting me to be present evidence to the committee this morning. I'm David Allen from Scottish Community Development Centre. Scottish Community Development Centre is a body for community development in Scotland for good practice in community engagement, community research, community capacity building across Scotland, working at a range of levels from policy through practice to working directly with communities and community organisations.
Thanks, David. Pippa, could I invite you to introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about the organisation that you work for?
Yes, thank you. Thanks for having me here this morning. I'm Pippa Coutts. I work with Carnegie UK. We are an endowment. We work across the UK and Ireland to promote wellbeing. We've got a particular focus on community wellbeing, and though we're a policy organisation, we have strong links into communities and a desire to promote enabling states where communities are further empowered. Thank you.
Thanks, Pippa. Anna, could I ask you to introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your organisation?
Hi, thank you very much for having me. I'm Anna Fowley. I'm the Chief Exec of the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations. So we're the national membership body for charities, community organisations and social enterprises.
Thanks, Anna. Ewan, could I ask you to introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your organisation?
Good morning. Thank you very much for having me too. I'm Ewan Leach. I'm the Chief Executive of Surf Scotland's Regeneration Forum. We're a network organisation of over 300 members, ranging from local authorities to housing associations to community groups, with a focus on the regeneration of deprived communities in a holistic way, making sure that the community lead on that regeneration process.
Thanks, Ewan. And finally, Ryan. Do you want to introduce yourself, Ryan, and tell us a little bit about the organisation that you're involved with?
Thank you very much. I'm Ryan Smart. I'm the centre manager for a charity, a SCIO, based in Glenrothes and Fife. We're a small charity or community centre that runs in one of the most deprived areas in Glenrothes, very much at the coalface, working with families, the community, and individuals on a number of projects and initiatives in Glenrothes North.
Thanks, Ryan. And Ryan, you're here not least because the Colleydean Community Centre was one of the featured case studies in the briefing paper that was produced. So we thought it would be good to have somebody with that on the ground experience joining us. The themes that we want to cover this morning are largely grouped into three areas. One is we want to begin by looking at key factors that lie behind what has worked well during the pandemic. Secondly, we want to reflect a little bit and get your views on what you perceive as the risks perhaps being about how we might go back to the old ways and what we need to do to embed some of the good practices that have been experienced through the course of the last 18 months, 2 years. And then I think in the third section, we just want to concentrate on what can be done to strengthen community empowerment and participation across the public sector, building on any lessons that that you've learned over the course of this last period of time. I want to begin by looking at really what your experience has been and what your reflections are. It seems to me that because of the urgency of the situation facing some of our communities, that there has been a degree of agility, a degree of flexibility, and an extent to which the public sector has supported community bodies and placed trust in community bodies to deliver services and support to communities in a way that perhaps hasn't been seen previously. And you know, it's been put to me that some of the old red tape and bureaucracy has been set aside in order to make sure that things are delivered with speed. So I guess I just want to get your views on whether you think that's a fair summary of the picture. Has that not been the case everywhere? Has it been uneven? But also to maybe get your reflections on how things might have differed over the course of the last 18 months or so compared to how things were pre-pandemic. So I don't know whether, David, you want to come in first to kick us off on that, and then if others want to indicate if you want to come in, then we'll take you one by one. David.
Yes, thanks. Thanks for that. Yeah, I think we've managed to get a fairly good impression over the course of the last 18 years of how the response has developed from the community level. We've been involved in a number of collaborative initiatives to actually try and learn from the experience of community organisers. But particularly, we were involved in evaluating the RRR fund, the Response Recovery Resilience Fund, which was administered by Foundation Scotland over three phases. The first phase was a very rapid response phase immediately after the pandemic hit. And then the evaluation of phases two and three, which were over the subsequent 6 to 12 months. And that was kind of fairly small amounts of funding that went to community organisations to help them with their response initially to the pandemic and then the recovery from that. And what we found from that, and this was quite consistent across the board, was that small community organisations were very fleet of foot and very agile, as you've said, in terms of being able to respond very quickly to this hugely changing situation. And I think the fact that they were able to do that were supported through funders being willing just to trust them with, you know, applications which came in and were responded to and were paid out almost immediately, was a real kind of credit to the funders, but also a credit to the community organisers in terms of what they were able to do with that money. We also looked at the kind of impact they had with these relatively small amounts of funding. And we're talking about less than £5,000 in many cases, around about £1,000 in terms of immediate response. And what they were able to do with that was not only provide the immediate response, but also connect up with other people and bring in other sources of funding to actually deliver on to meet the needs of their local communities. And Ryan and Colladine were one of those organisations that did that and really stepped up to it. I think what's been probably most significant for us in looking at the evaluation of phases two and three of the funding, which is more about how they then supported that recovery out of the pandemic, was the extent to which local and quite small community organisations had taken a lead in their areas in terms of the pandemic response and wanted to continue to be involved in taking a lead in developing community resilience, community regeneration within their areas as well. That is something that is, I think for us, is still a bit of a gap because we're conscious that, you know, small local organisations need resource to be able to actually participate on an equal basis with public authorities and bodies who are kind of set up to do that. But the strength of that local community lead and community organisation lead in terms of these kind of things can't be overemphasised, I don't think. Very strongly, not just through that bit of work on evaluating the RRR fund, but also other things like cross-sector collaborations led by others, including SDV. And I'm happy to leave it at that just now, but those are kind of main impressions, I think.
Thanks, David. That is a very useful introduction to the conversation that we're going to have. I know that Anna Fowley and Pippa Coots both want to come in. I'm going to take, and I think Ryan was mentioned by David, so I'm going to bring him in, whether he likes it or not. So I'm going to go to Anna first of all, if you want to give us your reflections from an SCVO perspective. Anna.
Yeah, I think that I would agree with what David said and would build on that, and based on two things. So we've been doing some longitudinal research with some academics and various other organisations about the impact of the pandemic on the sector. But I would also commend to you a report called Together We Help. I emailed it to the clerk yesterday, but it was done by the collective, and it looked at the what made social action work during the pandemic and what we should hang on to, and also what was maybe more tricky. So I would say one of the things that we should need to remember was that we were in a crisis response. People mobilise, they have energy, they kind of get together and they go for the right thing at the time, but you can't sustain that, you can't rely on that. We've got to look at longer term ways, as David said, of supporting communities to continue to participate in a way that is sustainable and isn't just going to be exhausting, or indeed doing things that the sort of filling gaps at the public sector, because the public sector kind of was quite slow to kind of build on what happened in communities. And the other thing about funders was that public and independent funders didn't just move quickly on new funding, as David described. They also were really good at recognising that things that they had already put in place weren't going to work and weren't going to be sustainable. The organisations were able to flex and change what they were doing to meet the immediate need. That's quite unusual. Normally, there'd be lots of hoops to go through to do things like that because people are very focused on what was in the original terms. Whereas actually, there was a lot of flexibility with existing funding. And I think that's really important to remember and to hang on to, that the original outcome that was intended isn't always what's fit for purpose as you progress, not just in a crisis situation, but you can learn as you go along and think, actually, this could be a bit different and could be better. So just to sort of recognise that, I suppose.
Thanks, Anna. That's helpful. I'm going to go to Pippa before I ask Ryan to give his thoughts. And I think Ewan wants to come in as well. But Pippa, you're next up.
Thanks. As one of the organisations involved in setting up Together We Help with Cora and others, I would definitely recommend it, because they use community researchers during the pandemic. So it's a good way to get new voices. But in terms of what worked, I think partnership worked. And I know that's come across in your reports. But one of the key things, I think, was in some places there was a, whether they knew it or not, a degree of disaster preparedness. For example, where there were existing resilience groups which had been set up previously because of floods or snow. But having that kind of existing partnership, and of course, in some places where community planning is stronger, or at least the local aspect, the local community planning groups are stronger, that was also an existing partnership. So I think that having that bed of existing partnerships is really important. And we talk about it so often, but it's quite difficult to realise. And I think during the pandemic, for one of the reasons that Anna gave there, that it was realised. And I think it was also realised because there was trust that people had to come together. And I think the public sector trusted the local organisations and they were given some control. And there was a degree of burgeoning kind of understanding between different sectors, partially also in some places public sector frontline staff were redeployed and they went to the front line, and I think again that built trust. So something about moving towards more of a relational state, increasing the relations between individuals across different sectors, that really built stronger partnerships and enabled the community to respond quickly. So just urge, continuing focus on the hyperlocal going forwards, because I think that's what really worked, enabling the hyperlocal response. Thank you.
Thanks, Pippa. That's helpful. And I'll come back to a couple of the points you made in a moment. But I want to bring in Ryan before I ask Ewan to give us his perspective from the kind of regeneration forum. But Ryan, as I mentioned earlier on, you're the kind of lead person in one of the projects that was mentioned as a case study in the report. Do you want to give us your take on how things have been and what you saw emerging?
Yeah, certainly. What I would say for the committee's information, I came in as the centre manager sort of at the latter end of this process. Before me was Rose Duncan, but I am very much aware of what happened up until that point. I think one of the big things we've seen that's been mentioned is that sort of empty silo working. As we would call it, is that people working in isolations, especially in sort of smaller charities where we would maybe referrers on, but we wouldn't be as integrated as we needed to be. And I think we saw that happen in England with this. And I think one of the, I don't know, this is a question for later on, but one of the positive outcomes for that is we're actually looking at a number of different forums now being set up within the Glenrothes area, such as sort of food resilience and all these sort of things, which I think is absolutely fantastic. In regards to sort of when we're talking about sort of community empowerment and in my opinion, in the purest sense of the word, were we doing that as much as we could have? I think no, but we couldn't have, because we can't empower people if people are hungry, if people are starving, if people don't have gas, if they don't have electric. Then we need to be putting in these sort of basic principles of making sure that people have got these sort of needs met. And I think that's what we did do. I think as well as the local authority was very good for us. Fife Voluntary Action was very good in taking the lead and sort of across the local authority along with the council and getting that. I think one of the things that we did sort of struggle with was we were very, very good at that initial response of somebody in crisis and they've not got food or they've not got whatever that was they need and being able to act to that very, very quickly. But I think where we struggled was sometimes that follow-up process because very much we were an anchor organisation and a crisis centre, we did that as much as we could, but where maybe a housing officer who would go out and speak to somebody for the council wasn't able to do that because of restrictions, because of rules put in place as well. So I think that was one of the sort of barriers. But I think as we got on through the pandemic, we were able to sort of rectify these, because in the very, very early days, it was very, very scary. And what Rose, the previous manager, did do at the very start was ask the staff within the centre, is this something that we want to do? Or do we go and do we close the doors? And it was very much the staff and those at the time that went, no, we need to keep the centre open because people in this community need us. And this is the time that they need us. So they stepped up. And there was a lot of fear at that time because people, even governments, didn't know what were going to be the effects. But back in March 2020, there really was that sort of few weeks of what are we doing here and how do we mobilise, if that makes sense.
Yep, no, that makes perfect sense. And again, we'll return to some of these themes as the morning goes on. But I do want to bring in Ewan Leach from SURF to give us his perspective on some of the challenges and how the challenges have been risen to.
Thanks very much. Like Ryan, I should say I'm new. I joined SURF in May, so I'm drawing on the work that my colleagues Emma and Delaine, who formerly worked for SURF, did during the pandemic and or in the early stages of it. They did a lot of research with our network, drawing on the experience of about 150 organisations to find out what they were doing in the early stages, followed up by some regional research looking at where the differences across Scotland and the experience of it. I'm not going to repeat what everyone else has said, but collaboration, the reduction of risk aversion from funders and public authorities were the dramatic things that happened. But it reflects the fact it was seen as an immediate crisis to some really basic human needs, access to food, that made that happen. Which I suppose brings the question is, are we viewing some of the other things around poverty as immediate and as important as the ones that we faced due to the pandemic? So it was because of that real sort of crisis situation that there was a response. The response was kind of slow to begin with from some public authorities, and it was the fact that community groups were so close to the communities that they were able to identify where help was needed. One of the things that came out in our research, and because of what happened, SURF runs as an annual award process for regeneration, and there was a specific award relating to organisation's response to the pandemic, and that went to Lark Hall Community Network, as it's now called. But their good work was based on the fact that there was a community plan undertaken just before the pandemic hit in 2019, which meant they'd had about 34,000 interactions with the community. So they had already begun doing some work. So where those community networks were beginning to happen, they then had access to people that they had already interacted with. So places that were in a slightly better position, I think somebody else referred to disaster preparedness, then they were able to step in really fast at that point. And I think one of the other learning or one of their feedback to funders, and it happened during COVID, was there's a big need for core funding. Most funding is project-based, but actually the organisations need funding merely just to exist, not just to do specific projects. But that ties into, during the pandemic, funding became responsive to community need. So the communities were saying, this is what we need to spend the money on, rather than saying funders have certain criteria that they would like to see certain agendas and sort of delivered, that's their preference. That switched to what the communities were saying they knew and were able to identify locally. So that's one of the things that happened during the pandemic, which we would hope would carry on beyond the pandemic. And we're in a kind of liminal stage because the pandemic's clearly not over, and funders are reviewing their processes. That remains to kind of be seen as to whether or not that will continue.
Thanks, Ewan. And that, I think, will be a recurring theme in our discussions this morning, the extent to which the and I think Pippa talked about a shift in control, and has there been a shift in control and power? Has there been a decentralisation? Has there been greater community empowerment? Is something which is of interest to us, and whether that is temporary, was temporary, or is permanent. We are the Public Audit Committee, and I do want to ask the Auditor General to give us his view, and not least perhaps because one of the things that it's important, I think, that we do cover is the extent to which there has been an evaluation of this experience, the extent to which this has been measured, the extent to which any good practice is being disseminated, the extent to which lessons that have been learned as we go along are being embedded into the way we're going to look at things in the future. So give us a general view, Auditor General, then, if you want to do your best to help us understand the extent to which there's been an evaluation of the times that we've been living through in the context of the community empowerment agenda.
Many thanks, Convener. I think the first thing I'd say is, in terms of the themes that colleagues have mentioned this morning, actually, I think we recognise those very clearly from the five principles of successful community empowerment from the 2019 report and the update that came through last month, and the strength of pre-existing relationships, variation in culture that's needed to respond to different contexts. And very much, I think the point that Pippa clearly makes, and Ewan likewise, that it took a crisis for much of the change to happen for communities to be empowered to take some of the decision making that they know best as to kind of the needs of individual communities across the country. But what's the sustainability model as we move forward is a fundamentally important point. You ask about evaluation, maybe come to that in a minute. I'm keen to say a word, and I know it's one of your themes for later on, actually, about the sense of red tape or bureaucracy that inhibits some of the risk-taking and the decisions happening where they needed to happen and the actions taken. So we recognise that a lot, that colleagues have mentioned, that some of those criteria that existed before the pandemic were stripped right back, so that the pace of action that needed to happen took place much more quickly, and that was essential. But it matters now as to, is that the state that's going to remain, or are we going to revert back to probably a more risk-constrained environment? You would expect me, Convener, to advocate for, there's a need for some degree of evaluation controls, a sense of following the public pound. But I think it's important now that when we go through the evaluation model, and that funders have a sense of, well, what was actually necessary to ensure value for money, audit trails and so forth, and what really wasn't. And one last thing I would say, and I'm happy to say a bit more about our programme of forward work, is that we recognise there's an audit role in here too, Convener. We're part of this ecosystem and culture, and we often hear back the comment that we need to do this because the auditors will expect it or demand it. And I think we are keen to push back against that somewhat, is that actually the evaluation most fundamentally matters about what were the outcomes that were achieved for this, and as opposed to having an audit trail or bureaucracy for the sake of it. And auditors, we are part of that conversation and doing so across the 200 plus public bodies that we audit. plenty of evaluation to come, and our own work programme continues to build upon how well COVID money has been spent over the course of next year. And I can say a word or two about that later if you wish.
That's great. Thank you very much. And I think, you know, the emphasis on outcomes is right, because, you know, we were living in unprecedented times with people, you know, at risk of hunger, of isolation and all the things that go along with that. So I think we've already heard of some of the experiences of communities rallying around and coming together and making sure that people do not fall between the cracks. So we've got a large number of questions and areas for discussion this morning. So I want to move things on and ask Sharon Dowie to get the next part of the conversation going. Sharon.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning again, everybody. You have kind of touched on some of the subjects, actually. We worked differently during the pandemic. We definitely worked at pace. We had to change our ways of working. I think David had went and said people were fleet of foot and agile. There's a couple of comments about the public bodies being slower, but it's certainly recognised that the third sector certainly worked at pace and changed the ways of working as they were going through. So I'd like to ask the extent to which the new ways of working are being sustained, and what were the enablers and the barriers during the pandemic? I don't know if Anna wants to go in that one first.
So, yeah, I think some things are being sustained, particularly when with independent funders. They've been really keen to learn, and we've been doing quite a lot of work with independent funders about how we can maintain some of that joint working, collaborative working, and a more proportionate approach to monitoring, evaluation and indeed application of funding. But I think that it's that sense that that Pippa talked about, in fact we've all probably talked about, of that collective approach in local areas is something that now the relationships are there, it will be more difficult to back off from that, and that's really positive. But for me, there's something about parity of esteem, and David referred to this at the very start as well, where we're in a situation, and we have been for many years, where we see the public sector, the private sector and the third sector, which becomes, it's as if there's a kind of, you know, you're the extras on the edge, whereas actually what we saw through the pandemic was the voluntary sector, voluntary organisations, community organisations, large and small, whatever their function, were absolutely at the heart of this and were really, really important. So what I would like to see is holding on to that visibility and recognition that we've seen from across political, you know, local and national politicians, even in the media with the public. I'd really like to see that being held on to and recognising the expertise that's in the sector, the trust, because the public trust community organisations and charities more than they trust the public or the private sector. Whether that's right or wrong, it doesn't matter at the moment, but we should be building on that and building on that kind of real focus on what people need and what works, rather than what organisational turf we're on or whose budget it's coming out of. And, you know, that's all important, but the primary thing should be the outcomes and the impact on individuals and communities. And I actually think, just to follow up on what the Auditor General was saying, is that I think that the work that the Accounts Commission and Audit Scotland are doing to actually embed the voice of the voluntary sector and of communities in their work and in their forward strategies is actually really inspiring. I think I think you can feel that commitment, and scrutiny does drive behaviour. So I'm hoping with that leadership that they're showing, that will help to drive change in the future.
Thank you very much. And David Allen, you want to come in next, David?
Yes, thanks. Yeah, and just to echo what Anna's just said, actually, I think the work that Audit Scotland and the other community bodies have done around about community empowerment has been hugely important over the past few years, and we've been involved in that along with other third sector organisations and cities on that. I just wanted to come back to a couple of things. I think just about, there's been a couple of mentions made of local authorities being a wee bit behind the game in terms of the COVID response. I think probably unsurprisingly, considering bigger the organisation, the longer it takes to turn around, if you like, and to shift things, and the smaller and more local and hyper-local think, as Pippa mentioned earlier on, the easier it is for those organisations to flex and respond quickly. But I think the other kind of main thing was the importance of communities coming together in collaboration. Somebody mentioned to me quite early on in the pandemic that there'd been an outbreak of peace in the community with community organisations who'd maybe traditionally been used to competing with each other for funding, actually coming together for the common good. And that was supported by the way funders approached it as well, as supporting, I suppose, more strategic approaches to how money is spent and used and allocated, particularly through the likes of community anchor organising. And I think that's a worthwhile thing to follow up on. I think something about local authority response needs to be acknowledged, that there are staff in local authorities whose role is about supporting community empowerment and community development. They're normally in community learning and development teams or similar teams within local authority. By and large, at the start of the pandemic, they were shifted to emergency response. So they were taken out of their traditional role, if you like, and shifted to the emergency response, which was a perfectly natural and obvious thing to do. I think what we need to see now, and hopefully that is developing, is that those staff are now coming back into the role that they're used to in terms of supporting communities and community responses and patient around about things like developing community resilience, community empowerment, local community influencing role as well. And they could be strengthened to continue to support those developments, if you like, and so that we don't kind of waste all that kind of energy and enthusiasm and the steps that have been made, led by communities themselves.
Thank you. And Ryan Smart. Ryan, do you want to come in?
Yeah, thanks. I completely agree with what's been said so far in regards to how it's looking on the ground. I think one of the things that we have seen is over the last sort of certainly as we're coming out this side of the pandemic, as we've seen, there have been less focus on the council being the lead on projects that are happening within an area and waiting for the council to come in and do something. And actually, we're seeing more and more as actually, whether it be in my area, whether it be us or Fife Voluntary Action or whoever it is locally, taking the lead and being the lead partner in that rather than waiting on the council, which I think is very, very good. Because as has been stated, the local, such as my organisation, my board of management are all people that live within a 5-minute walk of the centre. So they are from the communities that need it the most. And I think that's where we're seeing that change, rather than it being run for, or things run by the council or because whatever political party is in charge, whether it be local, at a local government level or at a national level. Actually, we're seeing that sort of change, which I think is very, 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 very good as well. And like it's been said again, the ability for funders to be able to be very, very flexible about what we're trying to achieve. Because again, when we look at an example for Colledean, we had a neighbourhood plan that was researched in 2019 and came out in sort of January, February 2020. And by April 2020, a lot of it was obsolete because there was no talk in there about social isolation and things like that. So I think, again, when we're talking about how will this be maintained, it's about that recognition of sort of local area plans being as flexible as they possibly can be. I think it's one of the things that will help that, and not being as stringent, because again, anything sort of pre March 2020 for local area plans are very, very different now. And actually, when we're looking at local area plans, we need specific local area plans in regards to that sort of COVID recovery, because I think it's very, very different to how other local area plans have been done, if that makes sense.
Yep, thank you. And Pippa Coates.
Hi. Yeah, it's really interesting to hear what's happening now, Ryan. I think I just, in answer to your question about the enablers, I think there's two points to make. One was very much as Anna was saying, this point about parity of esteem. I think although we've talked about partnership, and I'm a big fan of Christy, and I think I want to see it enacted,
we're not going to achieve it until there's mutual respect between different partners. And I know it's perhaps something of the past, but for a while there was always this kind of issue. If previously worked in the NHS, if you were working in the public sector, you know, you're always kind of asking, well, who is the third sector? How can I connect with the third sector? And we've got to realise that it's a very disparate group. There are the big NGOs, there are the SAMHs and the Alzheimer's Scotland, etc. But what we saw during the pandemic was the vitality of the hyperlocal agencies. And actually, many of them were not agencies. They were just a street where perhaps there was a volunteer group that was already acting, but they had no, they not had any constitution. They're not necessarily part of any umbrella body, no particular financial accounting. And they may have got, as you know, as described at the beginning, less than £5,000 during the pandemic. And that really helped because it enabled them to pay for really basic stuff, you know, whether that was just to pay for, you know, snacks or to pay for people's out-of-pocket expenses, etc. And I think we've got to understand and live with that complexity. And it's come up a lot as we've thought about how we're going to support and hear from people who are more diverse. And I think that's something that we've really got to think about going forwards, is how to involve people, no matter the difficulties around that or the complexity around that. And the other thing I think we've got really going for us, an enabler, is our policy. If you look at the piece of cross UK work I was involved in at the start, the end of 2021, start of 2021, called Shifting the Balance of Power with New Local, when we looked at the relationship between the third sector and between local authorities across the UK, Scotland and to a certain extent Wales come out strongly because of our Community Empowerment Act, because of the community planning structures. And so we've got the policy there, and I think we can really need to build on that to enable it to actually work out in practice. Thank you.
Thank you. And Ewan Leach.
Thanks very much. Yes, I would also repeat what Anna said, that the feedback we got from particular groups was they were now equal partners at a table, where previously they felt as the third sector, there was a hierarchy there. They felt that that had totally shifted in the service provision that they were giving during the pandemic. And I think reflecting what Pippa just said there, places where things happened faster was where there was a good record or register of community groups, which sometimes some third sector interface organisations hold. And so where that existed, then it meant it was easy to access a range of groups. But where that didn't exist, it was hard maybe to reach into those community groups from the public sector perspective. And as David said, there was a higher degree of working across community groups who'd previously been at war, but which was also something really beneficial that came out of it. But I suppose the thing that I'd written down after the Auditor General spoke was Christy, because some of the things that were needed to happen are about behaviour change. My predecessor, Andy Milne, would say, we've got policies coming at our ears and the policies are great, but it's the practice that isn't happening consistently enough yet on the ground. And so it's really looking at behaviour change within people who actually have, you know, if I'm honest, permanent, pretty secure jobs dealing with people who are in more precarious positions. And I suppose it's until we see Christy really rolling out, which inherent within Christy there are tensions around localising things, but you have to then accept a higher degree of risk. But going back to what David said at the beginning, I was looking over what's happened over the past 18 months, we've seen like colossal sums of money going to private sector organisations. I'm not necessarily saying in a Scottish perspective, which have been quite shocking in the kind of degree of scrutiny that has been not been applied to them. But it's quite small amounts of money that are going to community groups, which make really significant differences. So yes, there are potentially risks about having less red tape around them, but the benefits of those small amounts of money go much, much further in making a difference to communities that need a difference made to them.
Thank you. Right, lots of really good points there. Sorry, can I ask Stephen to come in now?
Thanks very much, Ms. Dowie. I'm really struck by a number of contributions from May, actually, and just that sense of, you know, clearly pandemic has reframed who we think of as our key workers in this country, and you clearly see that just about the incredible impact that Scotland's voluntary sector has played in sustaining communities in the crisis that we were in. I'd heard, you know, as I'm sure many of us has, about the competitive environment that exists within communities for funding, and recognising also that the vast scale of additional money that's come through over the course of the pandemic, and you know, and whether that will be sustained as and when we move out of the pandemic environment, and one of the keys will be about longer term financial sustainability, certainty, longer term financial planning. That if all we're operating in is a 12-month funding environment, that inevitably leads to poorer decisions, poorer longer term outcomes. So one of the enablers I think you'd asked about is that, you know, what we'd like to see is that there's that longer term environment that allows organisations to plan better for the impact of their work, be able to see that in a more efficient and a more effective set of proposals that come through.
Thank you. No, really, really good comments there. I think it was Pip had said about the partnership and mutual respect and who is the third sector. But I think after the pandemic, I don't think anybody's in any doubt who the third sector is. I don't think we would have got through it without you. So moving on to the next section, it's kind of similar themes in my questions about the risks around losing good practical and going back to the old ways of working. So there is a risk of losing the improvement and more efficient ways of working which have developed through the pandemic. So I would like to ask the extent to which public bodies are embedding the new approaches to community engagement in delivering public services. So currently, I don't know who wants to come in. It's been touched on in the last question there, but if... Let's see, any hands? David Allen.
Yeah, I'm not sure at the moment to what extent new approaches to community engagement are becoming embedded. And I think part of the difficulty with that is that we're still in this bit of a kind of phase of some people getting back into face-to-face working. Generally, that seems to be more the case in community settings where local authorities largely are still working remotely. In those kind of areas as well. So it's still a bit, for me, a bit tentative about what extent public authorities are taking on board the learning from the pandemic and how that can be, you know, turned into better practice. I'm not saying it's not happening at all, but I think it's quite early stages at the moment. We've got quite a focus in SCDC on promoting participatory budgeting, for example, and AB's been supported by Scottish Government and has also been supported by local authorities. Obviously, local authorities have 1% mainstream commitment now as well. But I think they are still, you know, not struggling necessarily, but, you know, finding that challenging to see how they can make their processes more participatory and genuinely involve people in influencing how budgets are spent and decisions are made as well. So there's a ways to go on that yet, but there are kind of doors opening on that. And I suppose for us, the main concern is the learning from the pandemic needs to be fed into that. Because if we don't learn from that and the kind of role of communities in taking a lead and influencing decision making, doing all the things like Ewan mentioned about community action planning and stuff like that, then we're just going to go back to that kind of being communities being done to in terms of the way decisions are made on and taken forward as well. And I think, again, encouraging learning from the pandemic in terms of the hyper-local is going to be really useful. We had a local governance review, which started before the pandemic hit, kind of stuttered a bit. And I think it'd be really useful, I think, to see that coming through quite strongly over the next period, because I think people have got an appetite for being involved in that discussion about local governance now, which maybe they didn't have so much beforehand.
Thank you. Pippa Coutts.
Hi. I'm also not sure. I think what the pandemic has reinforced is that we need more of a local and relational public sector, and many of the anecdotal stories we heard about the partnership working during the pandemic were that employees in the public sector, particularly those perhaps who were seconded to the front line, felt a real sense of, that's the right word, achievement, but it was a positive thing for them to feel more local and engaged and to engage in these very local partnerships. But there's a real barrier to that, and that's the ongoing siloed nature of our public sector. And as we know, it's definitely not only a Scottish disease, it's probably across the world. And I think we could just achieve a lot more if our performance management systems were changed and the operating incentives and the career reward structures, which at the moment seem to be very much of a siloed approach. And I think we need to develop, alongside the fantastic work of Audit Scotland we talked about earlier, develop structures which reward people for giving back some control to hyper-local organisations and reward people for developing strong and mutually respectful partnerships. Thank you.
Thank you. And Anna, you want to come back in?
Yeah, just a couple of short points, I hope. One, to say thank you very much to the Auditor General for making the point that I usually have to make about sustainable funding. Much appreciated. I think it kind of builds on the what Pippa said there about this is about how this isn't all about how the public sector works with the voluntary sector or the third sector. This is about how the public sector works together. And that's what we saw during the pandemic. And we've all talked about councils throughout this session, and they are the closest to their communities of the public bodies. They are doing great stuff and could be better. But what about all the rest? What about the NHS? What about the enterprise and skills agencies? What about all the rest of the public sector? What are they doing to build community empowerment? So councils might take a lead role on that, and I would say voluntary sector takes a really key role in delivery of that and working in partnership. But what about the rest of the public sector? What role is it playing in that? And I think in terms of making things happen, Ewan said, we've got so many reports and recommendations going back for decades. We've got great policy and legislation around community empowerment. We need to actually implement some of those recommendations. And I would say Social Renewal Advisory Board, and I would say the report I mentioned earlier in Together We Help, they've got great things in there that all support this. So could we not have any more commissions talking about stuff? Could we just do the things we know already? That would be nice. Thank you.
Thank you. Totally agree with you on that point. And could I ask Ryan Smart to come in?
I wholeheartedly agree with Anne there. I'm sure it will not come as a surprise. I think, as well as that, I think this is a great question, but I think it's a question we need to continue to ask. But it's very, very early in these stages. I think one of the issues we've got is when we're looking at whether it be the NHS or even Police Scotland or the council. I think the people that work in these organisations that are on the coal face as such want to do this work and want to continue working in this way. But when it comes to targets or service managers, sometimes have a different view because they're not based within the communities, they're based within HQ or they're based within the management blocky, wherever that is. And we need to sort of change that top-down approach to that more grassroots approach that we've seen during the pandemic as well. Because like I said, my board of management are all local people that live in the local community, but are the service managers for these sort of bigger organisations based in the communities that are most at need? Are they based in communities that are in the top 10% SMD areas, or are they based in areas that are more affluent? And when we're looking at the sort of the hardest hit areas, we are looking at these sort of SMD areas that where Colly Dean's based. We're looking at that, but how many of the service managers and these people actually have come from these areas and have lived that life that a single parent of a single parent's coming in and at that point of crisis and needing help. So I think these are sort of things that we need to sort of look at, and how do we maintain that going forward.
Thanks, Ryan. Great points here. And could I ask Stephen to come back in?
Very much. Of course, I agree with what's been said, actually, and a number of points, just to emphasise, if I may, about performance measures are too narrow. You know, there is still a lack of breadth across performance measures that for public bodies that encourages collaboration, shared working, that commitment to working across the traditional boundaries to lead to better outcomes, because ultimately users of public services care much less about the boundaries than those of us who are working in public bodies, and that needs to shift. I wanted to pick up the point about Anna made about, you know, absolutely local authorities are closest to their communities, but there are many national bodies who have very clear obligations under, you know, legislation, the Community Empowerment Act, for they too to play an important part in this, and that's often forgotten and not given enough emphasis. It's interesting that even, you know, a feature very clearly before the pandemic about the progress in implementing the Community Empowerment Act, and a couple of points were emphasised. One about participation requests, about not being, you know, strong enough in there, and even being seen as an indication that community empowerment hadn't worked well enough, which just feels, you know, quite a strange conclusion to reach. But the other thinking as public bodies emerge from the pandemic about the community control of assets, and there'll be many public bodies evaluating just, you know, working practice arrangements, their use of their estate. And we can expect, as people's habits have changed, whether it's, you know, the offices for workers or other assets that are widely held across the public sector, how those will be used in future, and whether, you know, they'd be better used by community organisations. So there'll be a very significant opportunity for community organisations and public bodies to progress, you know, with that part of the legislation for community benefit. So I think that the sense of it feels like it's too early to be definitive to say about, you know, the practices and the progress that we've seen over the pandemic is yet embedded. But there's a huge opportunity now just to continue some of that learning as and when we emerge from the pandemic.
Thank you, Stephen. And can I ask you and Leach to come in now as well?
I agree with what's already been said, but I suppose as an example, we work directly in two communities, and the response, so have things changed, is variable. We have two communities that are looking and have a direct interest in publicly owned assets. One local authority is bending over backwards, not marketing a property, has provided funding for a feasibility study for future community ownership and use. Another one just wanted access to a building just to use it for a weekend, but they were told no because it might conflict with the decorating scheme that they maybe had planned. It wasn't definite. It was a kind of bit of a computer says no. And like Ryan says, it's very often the community development workers at the front line who are responsive, but more senior management are maybe more risk averse and saying, well, it just doesn't fit in with other things, or what if it goes wrong? And so they're less likely to be flexible because they're not actually working and seeing what the needs directly of the community are. But picking up on what Stephen said, Scottish Futures Trust yesterday launched a new report called Living Well Locally. It ties into 20-minute neighbourhood type stuff. But again, it reflects on how we use public assets. And looking back over the pandemic, we know that in some of the communities our members were working in, where food was a need, schools could have been the school kitchens, the catering opportunity that lay within those buildings was great, but was inaccessible. And it ended up development trusts, museums, etc., and that were community owned, them opening their kitchens up. Whereas it could have been that we use that better. And I suppose thinking about how we actually use our public assets, such as schools, and making them multifunctional, so that they're used not just during the day, but they are accessible to the communities in the evening, is something that Scottish Futures Trust, you know, there's a lot of money in that organisation, and they are looking at the principles that would make these things of much wider benefit than just for these very narrow uses. And I suppose we're still waiting to see these things being enacted consistently in practice. But and as others have said, I think to be fair to the public authorities, whether or not that's local authorities or national agencies, they're also in a state of shock and have also been through extreme stress. They may not be individually in some of the financially precarious positions that some of the communities are, but nonetheless, they have been through a very stressful period. They are also exhausted. And so there is a sort of, we're having to go through this kind of liminal stage where we're kind of waiting to see what the fallout is. And we're still waiting to understand really what the economic fallout is in a much wider sense as well.
Thank you. Thanks all for your contributions. It's good.
Thanks for that. And I want to move things along a bit, and I'm conscious of time as well. But I think we're exploring some really important areas that that we certainly are keen to get your views on and your experience of, and perhaps some lessons that can be drawn from what's been happening. I want to ask Colin Beattie to come in. He's got a series of questions. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. Firstly, I'm very pleased that in the course of this discussion, we're recognising and highlighting the contribution that communities did make and are making during the COVID pandemic. Just to pick up on something that the Auditor General said about funding and funding's all too often on an annual basis, I suppose the problem with that is the Scottish Government's funded on an annual basis. And, it doesn't have a certainty as to what its budget's going to be. And that kind of trickles down to other organisations that get funded by the government. Makes it a bit harder. I think it's fairly common in the public sector these days. Everything's short term. But I'd like to look at our community groups and looking forward a wee bit from this. Because it's important, I think, that we don't lose the momentum that we've gained. Are public bodies now actually seeking feedback from communities on what's been learned about, from the pandemic? And how are they doing this? Maybe I can ask Ewan to comment first.
Are they asking for it? Some are. Funders, particularly private sector funders and some of the philanthropic funders, are asking for that feedback. We are not being approached for direct feedback from other public authorities, but they don't need to ask for it because Carnegie, CORA, SURF, SCDC, we're all providing evidence. So we're all providing examples and case studies, as we worked with Audit Scotland on that report as well, providing case studies around that. So some are, but not consistently so, and I suppose it comes back to what we were talking about in response to the last question, is are they yet in the position to be asking for that while they're still dealing with the consequences of the fallout? But so I'd say not consistently, no.
Could I maybe ask David Allen to comment on this?
Yeah, just to reinforce what Ewan's just said, I think some have been throughout the pandemic. I think one example I think is mentioned in the Audit Scotland report, which we've highlighted through our contact with them, as Argyll and Bute Council, who kind of worked throughout the pandemic and in conjunction with local community organisations, the anchors, to try and keep on top of what the response was, where they could best deploy their efforts and all that kind of collaboration as well. So I think it has been happening in various areas, but again, I agree with you, and it's not quite across the board yet, so it's still a bit patchy.
David, I guess it's quite important that we do learn these lessons, and is this the right time to be engaging to try and learn these lessons, or are we too early? Should we be doing this in 6 months or a year after the pandemic, hopefully, is adequately under control?
I think actually it is the right time. I mean, I think people are engaging online and in some instances now face-to-face, meeting safely. I think there's a danger if we leave it, 6-12 months down the line, that we lose the momentum, any momentum that was established during the pandemic, and kind of lose that kind of energy that was brought to, because as been mentioned by a couple of folk before, people are tired, but they do want to see something good come out of the other side of this experience, awful experience we've had over the past 18 months. So I think to not engage with people and find ways of engaging innovatively with people, a number of examples around about that we know about and can highlight. And you know, everybody on the ground knows that there are opportunities now, to much more opportunities to engage public bodies about, you know, how we develop more resilient our own community responses. So yeah, I think we need the time is right now, over the next few months. Otherwise we, you know, face losing that kind of momentum in it, around it.
Can I bring Anna Fowley in? Given that it's fairly limited so far, the number of public bodies that are seeking this sort of engagement and feedback, is there any indication that those that are seeking this feedback are actually making use of it in a positive way?
I don't have any information on that at the moment. It's the next phase of our longitudinal research. That's what we're just launching it next week, so that's what we'll be looking at in over that. So I'm afraid I don't have anything to add. I think Ewan and David are probably closer to it. If I could just push back slightly though, since you gave me the mic, on what you said about annual funding, is that when it's Scottish Government and local government, but the uncertainty is around the quantum. It's about how much you're going to get. It's not about the whether. Whereas for most voluntary and community organisations, it's whether or not they're going to get any funding. That's the issue. So councils and government or whatever are not issuing annual redundancy notices. There's not that same precariousness around it. So it's a fair point, but it's not quite to the same extent as it is in the voluntary sector. Thank you.
Maybe I could ask the Auditor General here. Presumably you're looking at this sort of community engagement about how public bodies are engaging with the community. The public bodies that are, is it mainly the council, which I would expect it would be perhaps? And if so, are you seeing any sign that the feedback that's being obtained is actually being used positively?
So you're right, it is predominantly local authorities who take a lead role in community engagement. And there are other bodies too. So, you know, the enterprise bodies, NHS, Police, Creative Scotland, have been in the bracket of being the funders over the course of the pandemic. In the sense of, I think your question about the kind of lessons learned, you know, and is now the right time, are we seeing that? I think in pockets is the answer, Mr. Beattie, probably. And I think that's probably a reasonable thing up to a point that, you know, we are still in the midst of the pandemic. The public bodies are still fulfilling their core purpose, of which community empowerment is one, in a different way than they would have been before the pandemic. What we look to do through this report, and will continue to do through our work, is to highlight the importance that we don't miss the opportunity to learn the lessons of what's worked well in terms of community empowerment and community engagement during the course of the pandemic, reverting back to practices that would have been in place beforehand, as and when people, you know, tend to go back to offices, maybe fall back into kind of the way things happened. I think some of the kind of earlier conversation this morning, that things weren't perfect in terms of community empowerment before the pandemic, you know, with the extent to which the Community Empowerment Act had been implemented, there was still a way to go across really all parts of the public sector, local government and other public bodies. And through, you know, what we've looked to do through this report that we're talking about this morning, is to say there are some terrific examples of where partnership working between public bodies and community groups have had that impact, to share that good practice, share that knowledge, and, you know, continue making further progress in community empowerment. We'll keep doing that through our work in reports that we've got and papers produced during 2022, and of course through our annual audit work, where we, in local government context, you know, look at the statutory duty of best value, which cover community empowerment, but also the wider duty that exists on all accountable officers of public bodies to implement the principles of best value.
Thank you. Maybe I can just ask a slightly different question in terms of approach. A lot of the changes that have been made during the pandemic have been, by the very nature, temporary. And are public bodies consulting on these, specifically on these temporary changes, in terms of how they take that forward, whether that's going to fall away, whether that's going to remain in place? Ryan, you're at the coalface. Have you been asked about this?
It's not something that I've been asked directly. I think it's been more about people reacting to the need. And I think when we're looking at the sort of evidence and stats, I mean, I can give you evidence, say, how many food parcels I gave out and or how many people we engaged with during the pandemic for different things. But I think a lot of the evidence that is coming forward for colleagues and sort of other public bodies are, it's anecdotal evidence that we're working on just now, just because we've not had that time to collate and bring evidence together. We've tried our best to keep numbers there, and that's why I said I can tell you how many food parcels Colleen gave out during the pandemic. But in regards to that sort of finer detail that we're in the longer term impact, they, well, what did that food parcel mean? I don't think that's there, but it's not something that's really been discussed. And I think it, like I said, it is sporadic depending on who you're asking for funding from, if that makes sense.
No, that's good. Pippa, have you seen any signs of good consultation on temporary changes?
No, not necessarily, but perhaps I would hope that people wouldn't be coming to us because we're a UK policy organisation. I'd hope the consultation would be happening at a local level. In answer to your question about whether this is the right time, I suppose taking into account what people have said around the degree of exhaustion, I think it is very much the right time because of what others have said, you know, there is now an opportunity. And actually, I remember about a year, 9 months ago, I spoke to some people in local areas working for third sector organisations who very much wanted to see the changes embedded, fearful about it reverting to how it was before, more of a top-down management approach. And I think it's the right time also because what others have said is that much of what we store in terms of the of underlying issues, I think Ryan said right at the beginning, the degree of sort of poverty, deprivation, people's access or lack of access to food, for example, food insecurity, that came out, much of that was revealed during the pandemic was actually there already. And that's also true with regard to inequality and the access of people with disabilities from ethnic diverse groups, et cetera, to policy making, their lack of access, that was there already and it came to a fore during the pandemic. But I think we have a responsibility to try to right those wrongs, some of which really would be helped by much more of a preventative approach. Again, something that Christy talks about, I think again, we're back to this idea of, can we more effectively enact the good policies and previous recommendations of very strong commissions? Can we get on and enact those? Thank you.
And can I just finally bring David Allen back in to comment on this question of public bodies consulting on temporary changes to determine, you know, are they going to fall away? Are they going to stay there? Are they just temporary for the pandemic? And so forth.
I mean, again, we don't have any kind of regular examples of that. Again, we're not working, you know, directly on the ground in local areas, and we tend to work through programmes and get kind of, in, as Ryan says, more anecdotal evidence or examples of that. But I'm not kind of aware of any kind of major kind of consultations around about temporary changes to the way public services are delivered. I know several authorities where they've done that kind of on an ongoing basis, but not particularly in relation to any kind of temporary changes. There's one thing I just wanted to kind of was ask more than anything else, rather than comment on, though, was that we are talking about local authorities a lot. Well, there are plenty of other public bodies out there. Is actually what's the role of community planning in all of that? I think there's, for me, there's a bit of a question here about where has community planning been in terms of the response, collaboration and coordination of efforts there. I thought that would have been quite a natural role for community planning partnerships. And, you know, I get the feeling that it's not been across the board, although I might be wrong. I don't know if I have other opinions about that.
You make a good point. Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you very much. And I think there is a broader discussion there, David, about the extent to which we've got any kind of participatory democracy beyond participatory budgets in local authorities, for example. You know, what is the engagement on that broader spectrum, which I know Anna has spoken about? It's not just about local government. What is the rest of the public sector doing about community empowerment? So I think these are strong themes which have really come out of this morning's session so far. We're into the kind of final part of the session that we've got, and I'm going to invite Craig Hoy to ask a few questions and steer us through this final section. Craig.
Thank you, convener, and welcome everyone. One question just perhaps that maybe hasn't been answered. I maybe want to use the closing stages just to look forward to see how we can strengthen community empowerment moving forward, because there are clearly still some challenges, despite the huge and at times heroic efforts, particularly of the third sector during COVID. And at this point in time, it might just be worth asking this question, maybe if David Allen from a national perspective, and then perhaps Ryan from a local perspective, is to what extent, despite all the progress that we've made, is there still a hard-to-reach group who we didn't manage to engage with during the pandemic? And what can we do on the basis of the learning that we have of the progress we've made to move forward and perhaps reach those marginalised groups for whatever the underlying reason is? How can we finally move forward and make sure that the legacy of this is that we do reach them in the future?
That's an interesting one. I think actually we've probably made more progress in engaging with, I wouldn't say hard to reach, I would say less heard groups through the pandemic. And primarily that was through working through those people who have contact, or those organisations who do have the contact with those less heard voices, whether it be community organisations with, you know, particular areas of the community and sections of the there as well, and actually supporting them to do that work much better and help them to engage with their community, their wider community. So I think that was something that I was struck with by when we looked at the evaluation of the RRR fund, for example, just the range of different kinds of community group and organisations were involved with that. Although they did reflect to us, one or two did reflect to us that they found parts of their community that they didn't know really existed. We didn't engage with them prior to the pandemic, and they just kind of highlighted the levels of need, which were even greater than they'd originally envisaged. So I think there's still a bit of work to be done on that, but definitely work through those organisations that have those networks and contacts locally and make use of the community networks that exist, because they are really, really strong, really, really useful, and that came out through the work of the pandemic. In terms of how we strengthen community empowerment moving forward, I think we need to build on work that's already been done. I think we need to build support for the anchor organisations and networks in local areas. We're already beginning a bit of work in looking at how resilience partnerships can be strengthened as well. I think it was one area that we thought maybe the existing resilience partnerships that were around maybe didn't quite connect with wider community networks at times and in certain areas. So it'd be really useful to look to strengthen those and their links across wider communities. And just as has been mentioned already in the session, you know, developing our approach to local governance, hyper-local approaches, really good, strong local community, flexible community action planning, community-led action planning, things like participatory budgeting and increased focus on more local control and more local influence. Yeah, also things that affect people.
Great. And Ryan, just from a sort of local perspective, obviously in Glenrothes, you were making the point that your board live within 5 minutes away, but sometimes the most extreme problems are the ones that are nearest to us and we don't see them. Do you feel like you've made progress on the ground in reaching people that you haven't engaged with before?
Yes, I think we have. I think one of the things that I worry about to a certain extent is that we got a huge amount of sort of volunteers come forward during the pandemic to help. But now we're at a point that even some of my staff are that COVID volunteering fatigue, because we're now going into the end of year two, and how do we sustain that? Because a lot of the work that we've done and working with these people to empower themselves to come forward, it's been a very, very intense sort of 2 years. So how do we then keep that up and keep the community's expectation of what they've been receiving in the last 2 years to where it should be? I think as well, one of the things we have seen, it's always been there, I would say, but we've seen it highlighted is actually we've not just got a COVID pandemic going on, we've got a mental health pandemic now because of this, because of the social isolation that's happened. And actually people are still scared to come out their house because of this. They're still scared to interact. And actually, how do we engage with these people that won't leave their house? And I think that's a huge thing that we've got to look at, and we've got to go, how do we overcome that barrier? Because if these people aren't going to open the door, how do we deal with that sort of thing? And how do we get work with partners in our NHS that when these people are going to the doctors and saying, I've got anxiety about depression, and the waiting list's 2 years to see a psychologist or a psychiatrist, then what is the community support there? Is it going to places like Andy's Man Club? Is it going to community groups and doing these things? How do we marry that up a bit better and make our public sector colleagues more aware of what's happening in the community to help with these people? I think that's one of the huge things. When we link that into sort of, again, well, like I said earlier on, in regards to sort of community empowerment, I think in regards to sort of like my management committee and volunteers have been very, very empowered, but weren't we individuals where we're at that crisis mode, where it's just feeding them, but how do we take that on and give them the tools to empower themselves? And the same, I would say, goes with mental health. I think when we're looking at how do we achieve this, again, Anna spoke about it earlier, about the funding. And one of the things for me as a centre manager, I think particularly hard, is if I wanted to apply for funding to employ two youth workers to run a mental health talk and cafe on at Colladine, which I do, it's relatively easy to find that funding. But actually the funding to employ the admin assistant to make sure all the admin's done in the background and the caretakers there to open the centre and make sure it's clean and it's all the COVID regulations are ticked, that's extremely difficult. And that's where that's where I'm struggling. I can get, I'm no blowing my own trumpet, I can get funding relatively easy to do project work and do this and do that. But actually the core costs of switching the lights on and giving a caretaker there and having an admin assistant there, who are just as key in this process, are particularly hard to do. And again, it goes on to what we were saying earlier on about that longer term funding. Now, I could have my mental health talk and cafe for a year, but I don't know if I'm going to have it next year. And I think when we go back to funders will go, well, what were the outcomes? And a lot of the time, you struggle because it's the long-term outcomes. It's the outcomes that if you're working with a young person at 13 with mental health issues, you're maybe not going to see. You'll see wee small things straight away, but actually the longer-term effects of that, we're not going to see for 3, 4, 5 years. And it's how do we capture that, and how do we explain that to funders? And I think what David says about, like I said earlier on, about local community plans, they need to be flexible, but actually there needs to be a great deal of work looked at these again, and actually a lot of them need put in the bin and started completely for scratch, because we are in a completely different world, whether that's nationally or locally.
Thanks. But Pippa, from a sort of national or perhaps international policy perspective, to move this forward to the next phase, it will be the political will and the and the public bodies that really set the framework that, that then allows community empowerment to thrive. To what extent do you think all parts of the public sector in Scotland today are supporting and empowering communities? And is there any international best practice or any policy that we could be drawing on as a ready-made template to try and embed that within Scotland to improve that empowerment and engagement?
Thank you very much, Ms. Hoy. I think, as I said, we have some very good policies in Scotland. We're often given as an example of good practice, particularly around the more holistic purpose of government, which we have within the National Performance Framework, which is a wellbeing framework. I think a severe challenge for us is supporting the public sector be comfortable with complexity, as myself and that's the Auditor General also has made the point. We have a real challenge in the siloed nature of the public sector and the target-driven nature of the public sector, which I think makes it much more difficult for managers and senior managers to be able to, as I say, take on the complexity, even within building strong partnerships with a hyper-local level, and even the complexity of understanding the third sector, which is a very disparate group, and requires, I suppose, patience and a degree of relational management, which is very difficult to do if you're in a system which is requiring you to deliver. And as I know, many people working at senior level currently in the public sector feel extremely stressed. And that may be because they have fewer people working in their teams than they had previously. It may be because of lack of funding, which means that they're just sort of very much thinking, well, you know, how can I house these homeless people, rather than necessarily thinking of much of a holistic approach around people's wider needs. So I think there is very much a need to support the public sector to try to think differently and to tackle these problems differently in much more of a future-focused, longer-term way. I think we have the answers. It's just how we can overcome the barriers that really stop people from acting in a relational and kind way, which would lead to a huge difference. Thank you.
Thanks. Could I just ask the same question, perhaps, of you? And you talked about the fact that your predecessor said, we don't need any more policy, we just need practice. How can we move that forward from taking the policy to, in practical terms, actually doing what Pippa was talking about there, which strikes me very much about moving away from firefighting and actually start to plan long term?
I suppose, picking up on your question and what Colin Beattie's question, coming back to that a bit as well, everything that needs to happen has already been said. So the things that we were saying before the pandemic became heightened during the pandemic, and behaviour did change during the pandemic, and we need that to continue. Equal sort of parity at the table, collaboration, all those things, long-term funding, core funding. We were all saying this 5 years ago. I was saying it at my previous job. We're continuing to say it, but it's become, this has become more important. Your question was an interesting one about international comparisons. So we often look at Scandinavian countries as a good example, and it's to do with how close local governance takes place, the principle of subsidiarity where decisions are made. These are also high tax states, and that is not by accident that those two things happen together. And so the local governance review, the outcome of that, you know, we're particularly interested in that. One of the interesting things about the local governance review, one of the final report for that was, I think community councils were maybe mentioned once in it, and it's kind of like, well, there's a layer of there's a layer of governance there which we could be utilising if funding for it was there, basically. So there are all sorts of things that could happen. We've all recommended they've happened. Anna, when I got in touch with Anna actually after she wrote a blog saying that she wouldn't be contributing to any more advisory groups because the SRAB, the Citizens Assembly. All sorts of recommendations have been made. They are consistent with what has been made for the past 10 years. It's changing behaviours within the local authorities and other public bodies. And to a degree, I suppose, there is, because of the mass resignations, the changes that are happening around employment, there is now maybe an opportunity for things as staff are changing. So new work practices and refreshed work practices are becoming maybe more embedded within public bodies, but it's taking far longer than is desirable.
I want to close by turning to the audit function, I suppose, and turning to Stephen. But before I do that, just to bring Anna Fowley in briefly, the Auditor General earlier said that audit performs far more of a function than a tick box exercise. It's about learning, evaluating, and assessing outcomes. Within your members, I think you've got about 2,700 members. Is there still a view that perhaps that audit and evaluation process comes at the end and is very much the tick box to close the project or to reapply for the funding? And do you think there's enough learning taking place within the sector to make sure that we evaluate, assess the outcomes, and then collectively learn from what has been achieved or what hasn't been achieved?
Okay, so I think there's two parts to that question. And one is about a public audit function, which is quite far removed from most of our members, who are generally quite small community organisations. And it's absolutely vital to be happening behind the scenes. And I think that that kind of collective accountability and making sure that our accountability frameworks in Scotland really look at outcomes, look at the NPF. Process is important, all of that is important. However, looking at outcomes and really bringing the National Performance Framework into to the fore in what all the scrutiny organisations do, I think is really important. But I think and I was thinking as Ewan was speaking there, there's a really important point here about learning within our sector as well. There's a lot of learning to be had from this, and especially that kind of managing to get away from the competitive environment, which of course when you get back into competitive tendering or just grant funding and even actually public fundraising, where there's the kilt walk and those kind of things, there's obviously an element of competition. But to try and park the competition so that we can share learning, that's something we're looking at, and others like the Third Sector Interfaces, for example, and Ewan's organisation are doing. So I think it is really important that we do that, because when you're an organisation like Ryan's, you're on the ground, you're delivering really good services, so it shouldn't be incumbent on you to add an extra layer onto that. The rest of us who've got national infrastructure or local infrastructure should be facilitating that and helping it, rather than expecting everybody to do everything themselves, I think.
Good. Thank you. And just to close with the Auditor General, the convener mentioned two words that I was going to bring up, which are participatory budgeting, which is obviously one of the very concrete examples of community engagement and empowerment. And taking that the local government budget's £11,108 million, by my maths, it's about £111 million is being spent through some degree of direction of community engagement. To what extent do you think more should be being done to audit that expenditure, if not through any mandatory sense, to ensure that we're not just making sure the public pound is being well spent, but to make sure, more importantly, that the audit function is evaluating outcomes so that we can all learn and share that best practice that would allow us to accelerate the work that we've heard of today?
Thank you. I think we're starting from a strong place in Scotland, and not one of complacency, and maybe say a word about the, as we've made no secret of, we're supporters of the National Performance Framework, that kind of has that connection between public spending and the outcomes. More needs to be done to move beyond the framework and better translate what's actually been spent and what the longer term outcomes for public spending of taxpayers' money. In terms of the audit model that we have in Scotland, we already operate a wider scope model of auditing. So as well as auditing the annual accounts, we also look at the value for money, best value arrangements of how well that money's been spent and what's actually being achieved from it. And in our paper, we have one of the case studies you've seen is on participatory budgeting and the success of that in Renfrewshire. Beyond that, though, there is a clear need for really, yes, for following the pandemic pound, of which participatory budgeting is an aspect of, but the communities closest to the delivery of service will know best for what's being achieved. So I think there's kind of two strands. That one is that auditors recognise and accept that, but so do the accountable officers of public bodies, that they know what they're achieving, that they create the right culture, the right conditions for service delivery to happen by communities who best understand. And as I mentioned earlier this morning, is that auditors have a clear role to play in this, that we rise to the challenge and challenge back where necessary, that we are inhibitors of innovation and risk-taking. Because I think for all the things we've seen over the pandemic, that yes, we can respond as a country in a crisis, but that innovation now needs to be sustained. And that the last thing I want for public audit is to thwart some of the innovation that's clearly so necessary to continue across public services in Scotland. So we're very clear that we've got an important role to support accountability, but to be enablers of some of the innovation and change that still needs to happen.
Thank you very much. I know that we've just got a few minutes left, and one of our members, Willie Coffey, is joining us virtually this morning. So I'm keen to bring in Willie, because I know that he has got some questions and some reflections on this morning's conversation. So Willie, over to you. You'll probably get the final word this morning.
Thanks very much, convener, and I've really enjoyed the contributions made by our colleagues. It's been absolutely fascinating. So most of the questions have been asked, so I was hoping to give our colleagues maybe a final chance, convener, to offer a final thought about what their key wish would be going forward. Now, we're the Audit Committee of the Scottish Parliament, and as is just discussed there, we have to, with the Auditor General's help, follow the public pound. But I was struck by some of Ryan's contributions in saying things like, you know, when you're giving good parcels to the families that are desperate for them, is that an audit function? How on earth do we audit things like that and the outcomes that flow from things like that? So I would wonder if I could just give our colleagues a wee chance to offer final thought about what a key ask would be going forward to protect and enhance and retain the good things, the good practices that have come through COVID, and how we would gain that into the future. So I'd really be obliged for maybe a short contribution from each of the panellists on that, convener, if that's possible.
Yes, of course it is. And could I ask perhaps Ryan to start this part of the session? Ryan.
For me, it's about listening to the communities. We need to continue to listen to our communities going forward, more than ever before. We need to listen to them. But again, we need the third sector. We need the funding to be able to do it. And we need, again, that sort of course funding that goes around the infrastructure, for me, is a huge thing that we need going forward. And we need the money, essentially, for the purposes of the Audit Committee. Is we need that money there to be able to look at that. I think we've got the COVID recovery grants that are coming in, that I'm in the process of applying for one just now. But I think that's for the next year, and actually we need some sort of commitment that'll be there for maybe the next 2 or 3 years, because we're still here. COVID's still hitting us, it's still affecting the most vulnerable people within our society, and we need that to continue, and we need the flexibility of funders to continue as well, and for all funders, not just government money, to continue with that and allow us to be at the end of a phone call and be able to make the decisions relatively quickly, going, I've applied for £10,000 to do this, however, we've quickly realised that this is now a priority, that can we use the money for this, and for that trust to continue to go, yes, use the money, because at the end of the day, we are helping the most vulnerable people within our society.
Okay, thanks for that, Ryan. Anna, perhaps?
Yeah, thank you to Ryan for saying the thing that I was thinking. So given Ryan has said all that, I'll say something about focusing on success and on outcomes, because the fear of failure is a big factor for public authorities, especially that fear of being hauled up in front of, whether it's a daily record, whether it's indeed the Public Audit Committee, or you know, that kind of sense of being cooled up for a procedural infringement can really get in the way. So that risk averseness, if we could be more enabling, be more trusting, and see it as a collective effort, and rather than focusing on individual targets, really see that collective effort to outcomes. I think that would be, that would make a big difference.
That's great, Anna. Thank you for that. Pippa, perhaps?
Hi, yes. I think to change our systems so we continue to hear from people who are less seldom heard. So that might mean more participatory democracy, for example. And I think to really support the development of performance management systems that enact the raison d'etre of the national performance framework. So that's well-being for all. So that means holistic management, holistic funding and performance management systems that support real partnership working and devolution of power to local communities.
Thank you, Pippa.
Thank you.
David?
Yeah, I mean, I think just one of the main things for me is to learn from the emergency, which we've lived through over the, to apply that to the ongoing emergency in our community of poverty and inequality. If we don't learn from how we've responded to that, apply that to the ongoing, if you like, emergency, then we'll be failing.
Thanks, David. Ewan, a final key ask from yourself?
Stop looking for new things, fund things that already exist, and need continued long-term support. But more fundamentally, and this is maybe something for the MSPs, prioritise the places that really need the funding. There are communities that really, really need it. There are communities that want it and that are really loud about wanting it. And within your constituencies, you'll have both. And it's quite difficult for you, I think, because of the, you're representing both communities, to support the ones that need it most, and for some people to accept that they are currently not going to be the beneficiary of public funding in the short term, when there are people with much more fundamental needs that need met. So prioritisation is something that I would strongly advocate in long-term funding.
Thanks, Ewan. Thank you very much for that. Okay, convener, back to you. Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed, and I would certainly echo loudly Ewan's final comments there. But I really want to thank each of the panellists for your contributions this morning. It's both been instructive, insightful, and I think has given us lots to think over about what we can do as the Public Audit Committee of the Scottish Parliament in ensuring that the harsh lessons that we've been forced to learn because of circumstances beyond our control are ones that are embedded into our public institutions, including this Parliament, but also find a ready echo in the communities that you all serve and that we seek to serve as well. So I'm going to have to draw the session to a close. I do want to emphasise, though, to those people who have been kind enough to join us this morning, if there are further things that you want to get across that you haven't had time because of the time pressures this morning, please don't hesitate to put in a written submission. It doesn't have to be an omnibus piece of work. It can be short, sharp and pithy. But if there are points that you've not felt you've had the opportunity to raise, or on reflection from this morning's session you think are important for us to consider, then please put something in writing to us, and we will consider that in our deliberations. But once again, thanks to all of you online. Thanks to the Auditor General for joining us in the committee room this morning. And I now draw the public part of today's committee meeting to a close. Thank you.